Do you feel that streaming atau OTT ini akhirnya memberikan fleksibilitas ke sutradara seperti Mas Teddy untuk explore more unconventional ideas gitu?
I want
Hello?
to answer correctly gitu ya, gimana ya?
Okay.
Jadi I have to think first. So you
No
can
worries, no
so you
worries.
can edit it. You can edit it.
Selamat datang kembali di The Industry, presented to you by OPPO. Sebuah acara mingguan tentang segala hal yang berhubungan dengan industri perfilman Indonesia, di mana saya, Arifin Putra, ngobrol dengan orang-orang berbakat yang memiliki passion yang sama dengan saya, cinema. So, without further ado, let's roll. Hai Teddy, apa kabar? How are you today?
I'm good, Arifin. How are you? Gimana? How's the quarantine?
I'm also good. Sayangnya kita belum pernah punya kesempatan untuk kerjasama selama ini, tapi I had a chance to work with Hanun before.
Yeah.
Tapi senang sekali akhirnya hari ini kita bisa ngobrol-ngobrol dikit ya.
Right.
So I hope that I can learn something from you today.
Okay.
Lahir di Jepang dan sekolahnya di UK ya. Yang akhirnya membuat Mas Teddy pengen balik ke Indonesia itu apa?
Waktu itu lumayan, because pindah-pindah kan, kebetulan saya, orang tua saya waktu itu diplomat, jadi pindah-pindah gitu. I was born in Tokyo, grew up in Austria, New York, and studied in the UK. Tapi jarang sekali kesempatan untuk tinggal di Indonesia gitu. So, when I graduated, pas sudah lulus, itu emang udah pasti I wanted to become a filmmaker, dan pingin mulainya tuh juga dari Indonesia gitu.
Oh, emang dari dulu udah tahu pengen jadi filmmaker?
Udah tahu mau jadi filmmaker, cuman nggak sekolah film. I wasn't fortunate enough untuk belajar film, karena waktu itu juga sama orang tua nggak dikasih untuk sekolah film. Because during the time saya kuliah itu kan juga industri film lagi nggak terlalu jalan, jadi he feels that itu education yang path yang nggak cocok gitu. Akhirnya I did something else. Actually I worked for Coca-Cola gitu. I worked for Coca-Cola and then after that I left the job to shoot a film. I shot a film judulnya Culik. Jadi I wrote a script pas saya lagi kerja di Coca-Cola. I shot the film with my friends. I picked up a 35mm camera and start shooting aja gitu dengan benar-benar nggak ngerti cara bikin film seperti apa. And funny enough, itu film itu mendapat jalur yang dapat uang sedikit dari the Göteborg Film Festival di Sweden. And then I had the opportunity to meet Mira Lesmana sama Riri Riza at the time. They were doing Kuldesak.
Oh, ini zaman-zaman Kuldesak. Wow, okay.
Zaman-zaman Kuldesak. So I heard that they were doing Kuldesak.
Wow.
And I told them that I'm also an Indonesian filmmaker yang bikin film. Mereka penasaran. And then at that time, itu filmnya tuh belum complete gitu. I didn't have money untuk finish it gitu. And then Mira Lesmana sama Riri gave some money to me to finish the film off and help me finish the film. I owe them my career gitu ya. Maksudnya karena I was a nobody dan dia akhirnya had faith in the film, gave me some money to finish it, help me do the post production. Akhirnya film itu tayang di G-Fest yang kedua kalau nggak salah. You know, looking back gitu, maksudnya it was so apa ya? It was so influenced by the films yang I grew up with watching gitu. Jadi karena saya nggak sekolah film, jadi most of my influences itu dari film-film yang saya tonton gitu. So that film reflected what I like watching as a growing up gitu aja sih.
Okay, kalau gitu, what were your inspirations growing up? Maksudnya dari segi filmnya maupun sutradaranya?
Macam-macam. Misalnya, I used to watch. Maksudnya kalau dari kecil tuh kan, I never miss a James Bond film, itu udah pasti gitu. I like films like that gitu. I never miss that. Tapi mungkin kalau ditarik from the 90s, it was the era of Quentin Tarantino. Jadi he released Reservoir Dogs, and then era itu juga ada Robert Rodriguez releasing El Mariachi, and the whole Tarantino phenomenon itu kayak memungkinkan orang yang tidak sekolah film untuk buat film juga. So this guy sort of gave hope to these non-film students to make a film gitu. Jadi based on that alone gitu, akhirnya oh it's possible ternyata ya, you don't really have to go to film school ternyata untuk bikin film gitu. Jadi akhirnya memacu saya untuk bikin film gitu. I think that was the turning point of what I wanted to do in the future gitu.
Kalau yang menarik juga kan dari Mas Teddy adalah bahwa Mas Teddy itu cukup lama di luar negeri tinggalnya maupun lahirnya, and as you said juga pindah-pindah ke beberapa negara. Nah pas akhirnya balik ke Indonesia dan menjadi seorang filmmaker, upbringing di luar negeri itu ada dampak ke your filmmaking style nggak sih?
I really really try to avoid the point of view of a tourist di making a film di Indonesia. Maksudnya kalau misalnya, I don't know, for those yang nonton kayak film My Trilogy lah, kayak Lovely Man atau Something in the Way About a Woman gitu, I try to make it as genuine, as authentic Indonesia banget. Jangan sampai kelihatannya tuh dari kacamata turis gitu, you know what I mean? Ya mungkin example-nya adalah kalau misalnya filmmaker Indonesia syuting di Paris misalnya, you're just tempted to shoot an Eiffel Tower shot, and you're just tempted to do the tourist kind of attraction, gitu kan? Sedangkan you don't have to shoot that to shoot in Paris, gitu. You don't have to shoot a Monas or a mall in Jakarta. You can shoot something else, gitu. You can. Jadi emang sudut pandang itu yang saya berusaha untuk tidak seperti turis, gitu. Ketika saya shooting konten yang from Indonesia gitu.
Jadi waktu akhirnya balik itu, kayak tadi kan Mas Teddy bilang bahwa pengen banget memperlihatkan cerita yang Indonesia banget gitu kan. Ya. Nah tapi kalau misalnya selama itu di luar terus akhirnya balik, kayak gimana sih proses untuk akhirnya menemukan cerita yang Indonesia banget atau keindonesiaan itu? Like what was that process like?
Nggak cepat yang pasti ya, because kan I started my career, I started doing music videos, and then I started doing, I did documentaries, I did, emang passionnya for storytelling, visual arts gitu atau apa, tapi untuk mendapat cerita yang saya mau bikin yang menurut saya, oh this is right gitu, probably it was the time yang saya mulai bikin film Lovely Man. Karena before that gitu, I shot films, I shot like Banyu Biru, I shot Ruang, I shot Badai Pasti Berlalu. Tapi it was apa ya? Kan every filmmaker tuh pasti ada growth di karyanya ya, pasti ada perkembangan. Pasti you never like your first film, you never like your second gitu. Kalau prinsip saya, my favorite film of mine is my next film gitu aja gitu. Karena there's always something wrong gitu. Kalau misalnya if you look back to your work gitu, and I rarely do gitu ya. Cuman maksudnya pasti itu perkembangan dari saya sebagai sutradara dan saya sebagai an artist gitu, dalam arti I can't pinpoint one film atau apa yang define apa dari karya saya yang define what, wah ini Indonesia banget atau this is the film that I like atau this is the film that defines it gitu, nggak bisa juga gitu. Cuman again I'm still searching aja sih at this point.
Kalau searching itu juga menarik karena ngelihat dari film-film yang Mas Teddy bikin ya, maksudnya kayak cerita tentang self-discovery seperti Banyu Biru atau misalnya perempuan yang berusaha untuk menyelamatkan rumah historisnya di rumah Maeda, dan tentunya juga Lovely Man ya. Itu apa yang menarik Mas Teddy ke cerita-cerita itu? Is that part of your discovery of finding the Indonesian story that you want to tell?
I never thought of it that way, dalam arti nggak pernah kepikir bahwa okay, harus bikin film yang Indonesia seperti apa, nggak juga, tapi I'm a full blown storyteller aja gitu. If I respond to a story atau if I have an idea gitu, keluarnya tuh emang karena I'm inspired by something gitu ya, tapi nggak pernah misinya untuk bikin film yang se-Indonesia mungkin atau apa tuh, nggak juga. Tapi kayak film kayak Banyu Biru gitu, I wanted to do a film sebenarnya about going through a change gitu kan. Jadi emang itu perubahan yang drastis, and then he starts recalling his past lives aja gitu. Sebenarnya Banyu Biru was a road movie, and I had a style of film that I wanted to make gitu pas buat bikin Banyu Biru. Tapi kalau buat Lovely Man itu simply because I wanted to do a father and daughter story gitu. Sebenarnya as simple as that gitu. There was no mission to convey a certain message atau apa, tapi benar-benar cuma mau bikin cerita tentang bapak sama anak aja sih, the dynamics of a bapak sama anak. Again, tadi you mentioned Rumah Maeda. Kalau Rumah Maeda was a different type of project karena it was assigned to me, jadi it was not a script that I wrote, it was a script yang ditulis sama Ayu Utami. Jadi I was assigned to direct that film gitu. Jadi beda approach-nya. It was a different approach to the type of films that I've been doing lately gitu. The first act of my career gitu, mostly itu I was a director for hire, I was a gun for hire gitu. Kayak misalnya saya dapat kesempatan untuk remake Badai Pasti Berlalu sama Raihanun gitu. Waktu itu PH-nya Astral Films. Saya dapat kesempatan untuk bikin film Rumah Maida. It was assigned to me by the producers. And then Banyu Biru was also, it was a story that I came up with, tapi we developed it together with Raya Makarim, sama Prima Rusdi, sama Shanti Harmain. That was with Salto Film gitu. Tapi setelah itu, ya kayak The Lovely Man atau Something in the Way itu about a woman. That was a film that I did under my own company. And it was a story that I came up with gitu. Mm-hmm. And then it was the three films itu tuh benar-benar director's cut-nya tuh ada di tangan saya gitu. Jadi it was different kind of approach to filmmaking aja.
Oke. Karena kalau Mas Teddy kan aku juga ngelihat bahwa it seems ya bahwa you do have the luxury mungkin bisa dibilang begitu ya. Untuk akhirnya juga memilih film-film yang emang Mas Teddy mau kerjain gitu. Would you say that's true?
I don't think it's a luxury juga, Finn. I don't think it's a luxury dalam arti I was kind of put in a position where I have to create my own projects. Kayak Lovely Man about Woman. I was put in a position. Okay. Put meaning the industry sort of menggiring saya ke arah yang seperti itu. Because I think when you're making film in the Indonesia kan, it's all about the opportunity gitu. Sometimes these major studios atau producers udah comfortable working with this director atau that director just had a big hit and so we're working with that director gitu. Jadi maksudnya kalau misalnya if there's a project going on gitu, I don't think I'm number 5 on their list of director that they want to approach to do the film for gitu. Karena I do different kinds of film gitu. I do films yang mungkin they see as personal films gitu. God knows how many projects yang I was pitched for yang akhirnya tayang atau apa. Tapi I didn't get to do it juga gitu. Tapi kan that's it's just the nature of the game and the nature of the industry gitu. At this point gitu, you can't beat yourself up over it gitu, you just have to try to make things happen gitu at this point gitu kan. Itu aja sih mungkin.
Hello everyone, we want to take a quick moment to thank our sponsor Oppo for making the show possible. All video calls and also behind the scenes are shot on Oppo using the Oppo Reno 4 Pro. Berkat chip Snapdragon 720G, performance dari HP ini nggak ada tandingannya. Jadi kalau kita multitasking, pindah dari satu aplikasi ke aplikasi lainnya, atau kita main game atau apapun juga, user experience-nya menjadi benar-benar seamless. Try it out. And now, back to our show. Ada lumayan banyak filmnya Mas Teddy yang akhirnya tayang di Netflix juga kan?
Yeah, we have Lovely Man and About a Woman kan main di Netflix. I think it gained more audience now than it did when it was released in 2011. That's funny menurut saya. Because people, you know, text me atau DM me atau whatever gitu ya, and then saying that there's Lovely Man gitu. It's a film padahal yang 2011 keluarnya. And I think because films kayak Lovely Man gitu emang probably it was not promoted in a more aggressive way gitu ya, nggak dipromote secara agresif atau and then people just have no interest in watching a film like that gitu when you go to the cinema gitu ya. Tapi when it's presented to you on a digital platform gitu, akhirnya yang it's already there gitu, mungkin akhirnya jadi more accessible kali ya.
Nah kalau misalnya dengan adanya OTT ini, film Mas Teddy yang mungkin sebelumnya as you said audiensnya nggak terlalu besar, sekarang akhirnya malah menjadi makin besar. Do you feel that streaming atau OTT ini akhirnya memberikan fleksibilitas ke sutradara seperti Mas Teddy untuk to explore more unconventional ideas gitu?
I want to answer correctly gitu ya, gimana ya?
Okay.
Jadi I have to think first. So you can,
no worries.
You can edit it. You can edit it nanti. My process of thinking you can edit. I like the cinema experience. I like the cinema experience. I like sitting among strangers and commit to a work of art for 2.5 hours to 90 minutes. We're committed to that work of art for 90 minutes among strangers and get that cinematic experience. I like that. I miss that. Gitu. Jadi if I make a film, I want to present it that way sebenarnya. So kalau di digital platform ini, you can always pause it and go to the bathroom. You can always, you know, pause it and watch it in another day gitu kan, bisa kan sebenarnya kan. You lose that magic aja of sitting in a dark room with strangers and watching a film that way and presenting a film that way. Gitu. Jadi I think that would be my answer gitu. Jadi tapi I also like the idea of this digital platform giving new audience for my work gitu. Of course gitu. Itu I appreciate so much because I appreciate siapapun yang bisa kesempatan nonton film saya. Tapi when I do a film gitu, mindset saya ya cinema man, you gotta show it on big screen, you gotta watch it with strangers, you know, takutnya bareng-bareng, ketawanya bareng-bareng gitu, you know what I mean. Jadi itu yang sebenarnya saya suka. Does that make sense?
Yeah, no, it does. It makes perfect sense. Jadi tetap masih suka the romance of cinema ya. Mas Teddy, kedepannya ada rencana apa lagi? Like, what's next for Teddy Suryatmaja? Sekarang just riding out the pandemic and then see what happens after that? Atau udah ada rencana untuk film-film selanjutnya, like your own films gitu?
I think this pandemic sucks banget sih. Maksudnya?
Yep.
This pandemic sucks banget. Maksudnya kan, I think for the first time in our lives gitu, bahwa everybody in this world is going through the same problem gitu kan. The same problem of uncertainty gitu kan. Itu yang kita dikasih kan. Itu dan itu kan uncertainty adalah sesuatu yang semua orang enggak suka kok. Enggak ada orang yang suka uncertainty gitu. And then we are now put in that position gitu. And I think there's also some sort of the feeling, the sense of uncertainty juga di industri ini gitu kan, dengan bioskop belum buka, terus dengan apa projects being pushed back to whenever atau apa gitu. Because I was already in the middle of a preparation sebenarnya kan. I was already prepping a film with Mira and Miles Film. Tapi it was supposed to shoot last August, tapi akhirnya mundur ke December. December juga mundur ke tahun depan gitu. Jadi again, this uncertainty juga bikin gak nyaman gitu. Tapi right now, I have a film yang is in post-production, which we shot before the pandemic. So hopefully we can see the light of day of that film gitu. Cuman apart from that sih, I think yeah, at this point gimana lagi, Vin? You have to ride it out dulu kali ya.
Ya ada sesuatu yang positif nggak kita bisa ambil dari pandemi ini untuk industri kita?
I don't know. Cuman yang pasti, you know what? Maksudnya ya, yang pasti gini. Next time I'm on set, on a film set, I will never take it for granted aja gitu. Karena I really miss being on set right now. You know what I mean? I really miss the late nights of shooting a film, the long hours. Mungkin kalau misalnya dulu-dulu saya pernah ngeluh atau apa atau marah atau on set yang bikin gak nyaman atau apa, I really really regret it now karena I really miss that. I really miss being amongst friends, working the crews, the actors, you know, apa I really miss having to apa preview my film on the big screen in cinemas during a premiere gitu. Jadi there's so many things I miss about the film industry.
See? You did it.
Yeah, see?
You end on a high note.
Okay.
Terima kasih udah nyempetin waktu untuk ngobrol-ngobrol. Stay safe, stay healthy, dan ya semoga kita bisa ketemu suatu hari nanti ya.
Cool. Thanks, Vin.
Okay, thank you. Bye-bye. Thank you so much.
Bye, thanks.
Itu dia, Teddy Suryatmaja. Menarik ya. Dan untuk menjawab pertanyaan saya di awal acara, ternyata Teddy dapat merilis film-film kontroversial karena ia memutuskan untuk memproduksi sendiri filmnya.
agar ia dapat menyampaikan cerita yang ia rasa perlu disampaikan. Very interesting approach. Kalau kalian penasaran dengan film-film Mas Teddy, langsung aja cek di Netflix. Dan kalau kalian suka episode kali ini, like, subscribe, dan kalau ada pertanyaan atau komentar tambahan, langsung komentar di bawah. Supaya kalian tidak ketinggalan episode selanjutnya dari The Industry, presented to you by Oppo, tekan tombol lonceng. And that's it for today. Thank you to all cinemites out there. Stay safe, stay healthy, wash your hands, and that's a wrap.